I'm Dara Brey, and welcome to my School of Hard Sums. We're here to solve one of life's great mysteries, namely, when it comes to tackling practical, everyday problems, which is the best course of action? Should you use the clear, mathematical, rational approach, or should you blunder along aimlessly and hope for the best?
This show is a battle of brain versus brawn, and tonight I shall be playing the role of Brey. Each week, my grey matter is pitched against the brute force of my two comic guests, as we tackle three increasingly fiendish problems that we've never seen before. Oxford professor Marcus de Sotoy is here to set the questions and decide whose approach is the best. And to keep us all on our toes, there's a bunch of brainy math students having a crack as well. But first, let's meet my competition for tonight. Josh Widdicombe and Marcus Brigston.
Hello, gentlemen. How are you?
Good.
Very well, thanks.
Thank you very much for coming in and playing the role of brute force.
Thank you. It's a role I was born to play.
Yes. Would you choose that part normally? Or, you know,
I like rationality. I like lists.
Really?
An order and everything to be in its right place.
It sounds more like OCD, to be honest.
I passed a major maths threshold last year when my son turned 9 and I'm no longer able to help him with his homework.
Wow, we are at that point,
so much earlier than I'd thought, where, you know, he'd come to me with a thing and I'd have to go, that looks good. I'll tell you what we're going to do is you're going to look it up.
Did you say in a modern knowledge-based economy, the ability to seek answers for yourself using a search engine is as valuable to employers in the future?
Rather than your dad, who even just looking at the question has given me a small nosebleed.
We're also going to start off really on the nursery slopes, as we always do.
Yeah, we're going to get your neurons firing with a few easy problems.
Do we have themes, Marcus?
Yes, we have got a theme. This is about how maths can get you more bang for your buck.
Wonderful.
And the first one's about those fuses you see in the cartoons where you light one end and it goes...
Under the big round bomb.
Yeah, exactly. So we've got no bombs, but we've got fuses. So the fuses take 1 minute to burn from one end to the other. But the problem is they don't burn at a uniform rate. So sometimes they speed up, slow down, speed up. But we know that one fuse takes 1 minute. But I want you to find a way to measure 45 seconds using these fuses.
Okay.
So we need to work out how to measure 45 seconds using fuses that burn for 60 seconds. If the fuses burned evenly, you could just cut a quarter off the length and reduce the time by a quarter too. But the fuses don't burn evenly, so how do you do it?
Shall we put these on?
Absolutely, we're going to be blowing things up.
This is similar now to the experience of watching a 3D film in that I'm uncomfortable and quite unhappy.
Oh, yeah. I've got a slight issue in the gloves.
You don't need these
I
yet.
Yeah.
Gosh, you're getting ahead of yourself.
Oh, sorry.
So take the gloves off, because
I've got a history of arson.
Okay. I'm volunteering to be the Wile E. Coyote in this thing, and no matter what happens with the lit fuse, I will be seen at the end with smoke coming out of my ears.
Is this a genuinely fuse off?
These are genuinely fuses, and once you've got a method, we're going to try it out.
Could we just say one Mississippi, two Mississippi, up to 45?
Is that how you count? Is that how you count?
That's how we were told to do it at school.
By the way, can I just point out, because we've had them here and
they've literally
scribbling stuff furiously.
It's going to be an overlapping thing, isn't it? Of kind of starting one going.
Yeah. And then...
That's a good start.
45 seconds later, we know we've done it.
Do you want me to give you an easier problem to start?
Yes, go on.
How could you measure 30 seconds with this fuse?
So you double it over.
Yeah.
Yes.
Light it from the middle.
No, light it from the middle, but...
Light it from both ends.
Well done.
All right, should we do that? Let's see what happens if you light it from both ends.
Okay.
So you can start it off like that if you want. Get flames
ready. Get your flame going, gentlemen.
So, Don't do it on one. Go.
Yeah. 3, 2, 1, go.
Okay.
3, 2, 1, go.
Wow, that is gratifying.
You've set fire to the middle.
You've actually made it.
What I've done there is mistakenly solved the 45 second problem.
That's so good, though.
That is amazing.
It's great.
That is fantastic. It's a sparkler, basically.
Yes. I don't think we should point fingers at who got that wrong.
No,
fair enough.
This is what I'm thinking, right? You light one of them, either side. You light one from one side.
Oh!
Come on.
I think I've got it. Okay, so what
did you really need to do this?
Take the fire away. There's a lot of product in there, but get it. I got it. Okay. You light two ends of one at once and one end of another.
Yeah.
When your flames join, in the middle of your first one, you light the second end of your other one.
Very good.
Very good.
Which
he's hot.
So should we try it then? So it's time at 45 seconds.
Wow, that's so pleased I got it right.
Can you just hold it out so we can stretch that a little bit so that we don't make the same error?
And Josh, when this goes out, you need to be primed and ready.
So the guy that really messed up the first time is the guy that's got
the key is probably a flaw.
You will also be holding the end of a fuse that's already on
lit.
Fire.
Yeah. And it'll be approaching you.
Heading towards your hand.
Wow. I feel like Indiana Jones. I'm going to implement a hot glove.
Yeah.
All right.
Do you want me to count you down?
We're on go, aren't we?
Would somebody be happy to say flame on?
No, that's an awful laughter. Why would you say flame on?
I just think it'd be nice if we all want an initial ignition state.
You want us to all do this. Oh, hang on. There we go. Right.
Flame on.
Yes!
Okay, Grant, I'm counting us down.
3, 2, 1, light.
I'm a light.
Okay, so Marcus, you're watching this one. Josh, you come over here ready.
This side of
you. Yeah.
Be ready. There, Josh, that needs to be in your hand.
I don't like this backseat fusing that you...
That's right, I'm using a lighter to push it away.
I'm flame on, guys.
So we're coming up to 30 seconds.
Now!
And okay, when that goes out...
We should be at 45 seconds.
This
exactly.
will have been a light for 45 seconds.
Wow, this really is. Or maybe the river gets doused by water.
45, Mississippi. That came out exactly 45 seconds.
Wow! Yes.
Very good.
Very good.
But of course, you shouldn't do this at home without all of the
requisite
glasses, safety gloves.
You shouldn't pick up your.
I like the thought that there's someone currently at home with a fuse and go, oh, well, if that's the case.
You'll get that. Of course, no one at this stage is going to admit to not getting.
So I think the winner of that first round is, well, Marcus and Josh. Sure. So that is the first round of Brawn.
OK, what is the next problem?
Next problem is about the maths of wrapping presents.
You set fire to one present.
So we've got two cubes here. They're 15 centimetres by 15 centimetres by 15 centimetres. The challenge is to wrap the cube with as little wrapping paper as possible, but the wrapping paper has to be rectangular and you mustn't be able to see the back of the wrapping paper. So the challenge is, what's the smallest area of wrapping paper you can get away with to wrap completely the cube in front of you?
I mean, in terms of saving paper, I don't know, but the most efficient way of wrapping this is to send it up to the fifth floor of John Lewis.
Now, it has to be a rectangular piece of wrapping paper that you're going to
use.
You can't cut it like that. That's not a rectangular piece of paper. What Dara's got on the board would, in fact, wrap it exactly with its surface area.
If I was really mean.
Yeah. Expand the cube.
Yes.
Yeah, man, expand that cube.
Now, I've got an idea here. Uh-huh. They're 15, aren't they?
15, yeah, that's right.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 16.
Excellent. Bit of maths there.
Cheers. So what you want is enough to come in from all the sides and meet in the middle. So what you need is the width of 2.
That would wrap it, but is that the most efficient
way? No. Well, obviously not, because of the way you've said that. Thank you for pointing out that, you know, I've put a marker down and nothing else.
Well, they've got to beat that.
Does it have to be wrapped as a continuous piece, or can we take pieces of the rectangle and...
You can't tear it up. It has to be a full... It's like origami. You need to do a piece of origami around this cube.
Okay, fine.
Do you mean the classic bloke wrap, where you haven't measured it, and then you've cut an extra strip and just... Yeah.
This is a mathematical derivation of that, because you'd have 15 here, and then you'd have 3¾ here, and 3¾ here. And what you do is you cut this bit out, and cut this bit out, and cut, and then you'd gaffer tape them to the side. Okay, join us after the break, and we will tackle the show's major problem. And the viewers now will find out exactly why Marcus and Josh have been doing this.
We've got two avocados and an Elvis wig.
From both of us.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Derby and School of Hard Sums. The programme that pits me against fellow comics, and they're using brawn, I'm using brainless. Marcus and Josh are winning so far, but we're in problem number two to find out if their method of doing it is better. And in this question, it's a question of whether we can wrap things as efficiently as possible using one sheet of rectangular paper. I've got that right?
That's right.
Yes.
What I'm going to do, because I've put my marker down.
Shall I give you a little hint? Whilst Dara is over.
Give us a massive.
Go on, then.
A narrow piece of wrapping paper might help you.
No. Oh, yes. Got it. So, because you're good at scissors, Marcus.
Amazing with
if
the scissors.
If you could just cut from here up to here the width of a... Just the width, just the width.
Nothing more.
So, in other words, you're trying to create a long... just.
If you're doing the minimum amount of paper...
I can still see some orange bombs.
Can
some
I?
There, you're also right, some you're there, right. If I'm honest.
There are some clever people here who've and this is this table here in particular, I've done this, where you could do that so it's underneath there.
But yeah, that's quite good. You need a change of direction somewhere in there.
You can only show the outside of the paper.
We're on something, aren't we?
Squares. I think you're losing two squares, or we just know better than this.
You're right.
Shall I give you a hint? Because actually the first thing you drew down there, Dara, is going to be key, that net there. If you could make that into a long, thin rectangle.
And if I couldn't?
Failed!
No, because this is, as in, like, you'd have a turn here, and so you'd have basically eight squares across, but with a turn.
Uh-huh. I think Josh is winning at the moment.
It's eight by
you
the...
don't need such surprise in your voice.
Sorry.
I see students folding their bits of paper.
I know, is that right?
Actually, are you twisting things around? Are you trying to do the turn, are you? That's what you're trying to do.
Yeah.
The turn. Are you getting the turn?
So if you have it...
So that's the base of the thing.
Yeah. There and there, and then so that one would go over. We couldn't get the paper long enough. But then this one you'd fold over like that, and then that does that side.
Yeah.
And you do the same on the other side. But
that
we
still
haven't got
gives you eight squares in the long run.
I mean, if that was perhaps longer, would you be able to do it?
Heard that before.
With
I think this has stumped pretty much everyone. I think I'm going to have to call time on this.
I'll go down to this. Yeah. You waste two faces.
I'm going to show you how you can do better than that. You can actually wrap a rectangle. So you want to take this one?
Yes,
here.
I will.
This piece of rectangular wrapping paper.
You're wrapping it. You're not putting a bandage on.
What you can do is to take that piece of long, thin wrapping paper. You fold this so it actually looks like your net, but you have to sort of wind backwards and forwards across the top square.
Okay.
And then you do the long rectangle you've got, and then the bottom square. So you only waste these little pieces at the end. So if I finish this off, so you go across here, fold, fold, and across back there. And this is the only wastage I've got.
Could you not lose even less by doing a 1.5 centimetre?
Very good question.
You're on fire. So in fact, if you made an even thinner strip, you'd waste even less wrapping paper. So in fact, if you took it down to a piece of wrapping paper that was one atom in diameter, that's about the smallest we can go. So the piece of paper would be very long. It would probably, it would stretch from here to halfway to Uranus. And that piece of wrapping paper, you could wrap around here and you'd have hardly any wastage at all.
A traditional shape or net that would wrap up a cube with no waste looks like this. But Marcus has said our paper has to be a rectangle. So wrapping a cube in the traditional way would waste 6 squares of paper. If you cut the paper into a long, thin strip 7.5 centimetres wide, you can weave it up and down one face, then four faces, then the final face of the cube using pairs of 45-degree folds. The waste is reduced to the folded area at the end of each strip. Marcus used a strip of paper 5 centimetres wide to wrap the cube in the studio and wove the paper up and down and back up the face of the cube, giving us this slightly different shape and an even smaller area of waste. So you can see, the narrower the strip, the smaller the waste.
You could do it with no wastage at all mathematically. In the mathematical world, we could go beyond an atom, just take it to an infinitesimally small piece of wrapping paper, infinitely long, and we'd be able to wrap that with no wastage at all.
Is that how your presents look at Christmas?
I mean, if you think...
And my family all get cubes. But you know, there's actually a place in everyday life that these folds are really important, not just in wrapping presents, but there's a fold that has been patented.
It's one of those things.
Did you say you
airbags in cars are actually, you have to fold the airbag up in a very particular way, such that when it fills with air, it expands very efficiently. Do you want to have a look at that one?
Can I unpick this?
Yeah, you can unpick that and see this. It's a very special fold that was, in fact, patented. And the person who patented it actually sued Ford for $100 million when they used it without permission. Josh, do you want a fold to have a go at?
Yeah.
There's something called the Ross Kemp fold.
Yeah, I know the Ross Kemp fold.
Do you know what the Ross Kemp
fold is? It turns out that you can fold Ross Kemp's face and still, in many ways, and still end up with a recognisable face. There is an entire subsection of the internet designed around folding Ross Kemp's face.
Does that only apply to Ross Kemp?
No, it applies to me as well.
I'd say that already looks a fair bit like Ross Kemp.
Surprisingly easy to do, aren't they?
God, it's fun, isn't it?
It is actually lots of fun. They should hand these out at children's birthdays.
That's fairly beautiful.
Do you think it works best on bald people?
Yeah, that's why it works on me as well.
Exactly. So we've actually got an example of a Dara
O'Brien. Oh, is it Darabin fold? I'd love to see a Darabin fold. Thank you very much.
I got made Stewie from Family Guy.
Well done. Congratulations.
Well, I don't think there is a winner for that round.
There isn't.
That one got you stumped. But actually, I think I'll give it to Josh because you set down the benchmark. And nobody beat that. So again, it's a brawn wins out over brain. So you've got a lot to do on this last question.
I do, don't I? Okay, join us after the break when we'll tear the Ross Kemp pictures out of our guests' hands and we will tackle the show's major problem.
But before that, here's something to ponder over the break. Which length of fence would allow you to create the biggest area of field? 2 metres, 20 metres or 200 metres? Before the break, I asked you which length of fence would allow you to create the biggest area of a field. 2 metres, 20 metres or 200 metres? The answer is 2 metres. Just wrap the fence around your waist and declare that you are outside the field.
Marcus and Josh are doing very, very well, but that might not last the major question tonight. Marcus, what's our big question?
This is a desert rescue you've got to perform. Your co-explorer has gone out into the desert, but his truck has broken down 55 miles away.
Okay.
At a base camp, you've got fuel there, but you've only got one truck. Now, your truck can only take a maximum of 2 gallons of petrol.
Right.
But it only goes at 30 miles per the gallon.
Okay.
So the challenge is, what's the least amount of fuel you need to be able to rescue him?
Okay. You've given this a go, haven't you?
We have.
In a way.
Yes.
It took us quite a while.
Quite a long day.
Okay. Well, I'm very intrigued to see how seriously you took this very, very difficult question. Let's see Josh and Marcus and how they attacked.
The desert, a hostile, unforgiving environment. And let's face it, the last place on Earth that you'd want to run out of fuel.
Except for Bobby Tracy on the outskirts of Dartmoor.
That's true, that is worse.
No phone reception.
Yeah.
Esso closed at 10 p.m.
Yeah. Okay, so the desert, the second worst place on Earth to run out of. And Woking, actually. The desert.
Paul Weller's from Woking.
Yeah, but even then. So, the desert, the third worst place on Earth to run out of fuel.
Though we are in a riding school in Kingston.
That's true.
Upon Thames.
But, you know, if you were in the desert and you had run out of fuel, imagine if they sent the two of us to rescue you. Whew.
So these are our props. So this is fuel.
Yeah.
Pretty light. And the sun was beating on the this is presumably Lance Armstrong's vehicle.
Is that a unit of fuel?
So that's one fuel. Can we taste this?
Oh, Lance, you are a disgrace. Not all of what's in here is going to be useful, mathematically speaking.
This is a student's car, presumably. These help because he's now nearer.
Is that him? Is that our friend?
Yeah, he's straight out the front of Topshop.
We've got 2 avocados and an Elvis wig. So we should be fine.
What I'm going to do, we're going to mark out 55 metres.
Yeah.
We're going to mark it with cones.
Good call. There's a lot of bending in maths, isn't there?
Every 10 metres,
palm tree.
I've just broken the palm tree, Marcus. I've broken the palm tree.
The top man at the end.
This is like bringing home a drunk friend at the moment. We are ready to do our challenge.
55 miles, each mile marked by a cone, every 10 miles, palm tree. My feeling is you'd need to get some of the fuel some of the way and leave it come back.
And then just repeat till we've done it?
Yeah.
And get to drive a golf buggy?
It's not that hard, this, Dara, by the way.
Back to the studio.
Yeah, you seem as if you're most of the way there.
I don't even know if we need the second half of the video. It's pretty obvious, job done.
So clearly the problem is dropping things off.
Yeah.
So you have to rescue someone 55 miles away but can only carry 60 miles worth of fuel. Not enough for the 110-mile round trip, so you'll have to stockpile fuel. On your first trip out, you could drive 10 miles, dump 40 miles of fuel and use the last 10 in your tank to get back. Then on the second trip out, you could drive 10 miles for the first dump, top up 10 miles, drive another 20, dump 20, drive back 20, top up 10, and get home. This will get you a bit closer. The question is, how efficiently can you do it?
I'm going to go and try to do this in some abstract and exact way.
Yeah, yeah. Very good.
Okay.
And,
good luck, Nair.
Good luck.
Right, what are we doing?
Well, this is actually a very real-world application of what you did, because this was a case in the Falklands War. It's the longest-range bombing exercise that ever been done. So this Vulcan bomber had to go from the Ascension Islands all the way down to the Falkland Islands, but there's just not enough fuel, so it had to be refueled on the way.
I dread to think how much fuel was wasted protecting a few folk and some penguins.
We're going to reenact.
We're going to refuel it.
So here we go. Yeah. Get you
oh,
into
thank
the,
you very much. Oh,
splendid.
I feel like a general.
You've gone with quite a jaunty...
Well, this is a revealing moment, because I've got quite a large head.
Whopper.
Right, so here's our fleet.
Right. And so we've got all of the stops where refuelling happened. Because sometimes you have to refuel the refuelling planes. Yeah, exactly. So here we are. They all take off, and then at stage one, the refuelling plane, Victor 1, goes and refuels the Vulcan. So that's
Victor 1 away.
All right, so stage 2, Victor 2... refuels Victor 3.
Two has refueled 3.
Two can now come home, because it's out of the
game.
So,
yeah. Home.
Okay, stage 3 now. This is really complicated, because Victors 4, 5 and 6 refueled 7, 8 and 9.
Do you think they'd have found it easier if they hadn't named all 11 planes Victor? That might have... That might have made it less complicated.
If it had been like Victor, Jeff, Nigel, Clive...
Yeah.
Victor 2.
Yeah.
Stage 4, Victor 1, refuels Vulcan again. Victor 7 now refuels Vulcan and refuels Victor 8. And then Victor 8 refuels its neighbour Victor 9.
How long did this take?
There and back was 16 hours.
Blimey!
Yeah. This is really complicated. Let's move it right to the end. So we've just got one left. So final stage 13, the Vulcan gets refueled by Victor 9, who returns to base. So, yeah, the Vulcan successfully hits the runway at Port Stanley with one of its 21 bombs, breaks radio silence to inform command that target has been hit and begins the return journey.
A phone call from Thatcher to, what was his name, Galtieri?
Galtieri.
Galtieri, explaining that things that are near you don't necessarily belong to you, would have saved a lot of this hassle, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but then we would have missed out on this great bit of maths, you see.
At least they resolved the issue in the Falkland Islands and it's not still rolling on.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. That's concluded.
So I think we can actually look at what Dara's been up to with his maths. There's a tablet by your side, which should show some of his workings. You can see the bit of maths here, because he's got a drop N.
So do you want to talk us through that?
N is any number, you see, so he's trying to do it very abstractly.
That's the same system my plumber used when he gave me a quote.
Yes, let N be a number.
How much would it cost? N. Any number.
So we can see a little, you see these ones, that he's got a half, a quarter, an eighth. So that's what we call a geometric progression in the trade. So where you're sort of halving each time, the distance,
exactly. A quarter of the distance, an eighth of the distance.
Yeah, but the trouble is, if you add a half plus a quarter plus an eighth, and just keep on going to infinity, do you know what that adds up to?
One.
It does, exactly.
No one expected that.
I'm loath to say, but that was a guess, but I'm
sticking
by
it. Well, it's absolutely right, because actually you can see that if you take a cake and you have half a cake, then you add quarter of a cake, and then an eighth of the cake, keep on halving it, you can see that you're never going to get over one. You're just adding...
Yeah.
It's actually the
are you ever going to reach one?
You can't quite reach one.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You'd get as near as damn it, but you can't actually do it.
At school, I remember a frog on a lily pad, and he's very tired, and each hop is half the length of the previous hop. How many hops will it take for him to reach the edge of the pond? And I remember this because I got into a row with my maths teacher at the point at which the frog could simply reach and pull hopless his body onto the bank. But the answer
just
is...
Just to check, there wasn't a real frog?
Several. Yeah, yeah. Our school have wonderful facilities. But yeah, but the answer was it never made it quite yeah. to the bank.
Well, I think actually with Darragh's strategy at the moment, he won't make it either because he's limiting himself a little bit by the fact that these halves and then... Oops. Does he? Oh.
Really?
Oh, okay. He thinks he might. Oh, okay. Right. Well, I shouldn't speak too soon. Do you anyway, want to have a look at what the students are doing, actually? Now, this is quite important to this problem. So, this is the harmonic series. Do either of you play a musical instrument?
No. Not really.
No. The notes which we like, which are in harmony to each other, are ones which are in a whole number ratio to each other. So, if you take a string and you pluck it on a guitar and then play half. The length of the string. You get a note an octave higher. So if you have one and then you have a half the length of the string, that's a note that sounds very harmonic because it's an octave.
Yeah.
So if you take it a third of the length of the string, you get another note, which is you get something to do with a perfect fifth. So we call this the harmonic series because it's related to the notes which are very harmonic. With this series, you can actually go as far as you want. So this one goes to infinity if you add up all of the fractions. So that's what that means when the student's written it diverges. So this is quite a useful...
What does that mean?
Diverges means it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger as you add more and more fractions. Mm.
Oh,
it goes off to infinity.
You know,
Darragh, how are you doing?
I feel like I've got an answer. I've got an answer, yeah.
Let's see what your answers are. Oh, you've got a little bit more workings up here, yeah.
Where N is equal to question mark.
Yeah, that's created mystery.
We should reveal that later.
What's your strategy?
What are you going to point out?
No, I'm just saying, how far have you got then in that first...
I've got half a fuel tank.
So you've gone 15...
Whatever it is, 60, whatever. No, half a fuel tank.
So it goes 30...
Excuse me, I got the wrong number. I thought 60 per hour.
If it could go 60 miles to the gallon...
It would be
you
very...
You could go there and back again.
Yes, you could go there and back. Well, not in... You're not helping by pointing
really
out how
sorry.
I screwed up. Because I had done... My dumping fuel technique was working really, really well.
I think you're thinking in the wrong way. If I did this, you
go on.
Might...
You're going to do something really irritating
if I did
now,
that.
Aren't you? You're something really irritating.
No.
So I should take a long hop to him and then back again. And I should take short hops up to that. OK, Grant, so we actually have to rewrite all this, and it looks ugly, but it's probably really pretty, which is really irritating. OK, while I'm trying to do that, let's have a look and see how those two go.
We've got the costumes.
Dressed now for the desert.
Yeah, and we've got the buggy, we've got the stick. So let's do maths.
We've worked out that we need to take some fuel some of the way and then come back and get more.
Yeah.
So we don't get confused about gallons and miles, what I propose is that one fuel unit takes us 1 mile and that we only refer to units of fuel against miles.
Yeah.
So we've got a full 60 here.
So what we're going to do is we're going to go 20 miles.
Yeah.
That's 20 of our 60. Leave 20.
Yeah.
And 20 back.
Done.
Good plan for the first one? No, I don't think we can do better than that. Right, let's bring this.
Drive on. We're stopping here. That's 20 units of fuel, Darragh.
That's used. Should we stockpile here?
I think so.
That's trip three.
It's trip three. 20 to get here. We've got our 20 to get back.
We've got 60 here. Now, this is how I'm looking at it. If we go home, come out with 50, that's job done.
Is it?
We've got 50 on here, 60 there, so that's 110, which is the route. Should we play this out?
Wait. I've seen a flaw potentially in your plan. Because we can only ever take 60 miles worth at a time, we're going to need more than this because we're going to need to go beyond and come back.
Turns out this problem's more difficult than we thought. That is strangling me.
No matter what, It's 70 back to here, so we can't get there and back in a one-er. Need to do a fuel drop at the next 20.
Why don't we need to do a fuel drop at the next 10? We go 5, deposit as many as we can, and will that allow us to do the full journey then? I think it might.
By going 5 from here?
No. Yeah.
It's from both of us. Add that up. Your proposal is we're going to go...
5.
5, drop 50.
Yep, come back 5.
And come back 5. So we've got a full 60 here.
So we're now going to do...
How many miles have we got to go?
That he is 30 away, so this should be 60 to get us back to this spot.
20, 30. You're a genius. You are a genius, mate.
Missed. Let's do this. Bring on the mannequin. Oh. Oh. He wasn't worth saving.
After everything we went through, he died.
At least we can get home.
OK, you have an answer, though, at the end of all this.
We
I also have an answer. How many gallons did you use?
Josh?
Marcus has done working, so I've just written the word 8.
OK, 8 gallons.
8 gallons.
4 full trips.
Right, I'm saying 3 full trips, and it was 6 gallons.
Yeah. OK.
Wow. Because of maths. The problem is I did what people normally do, which was probably what you did. I started from base and went out a bit and dropped some fuel and came back again and tried to do that, like whatever. That's actually the wrong way to go, because mathematically that isn't what you should do.
With this problem, the number of times you will visit each fuel dump determines how far apart you should place them. When you set up the first fuel dump, you make one journey out and one journey home. Here's the route to set up the second dump in blue and the final rescue route in purple. 6 trips, 4 trips, 2 trips. So how does this help us work out how far along the road our fuel dump should be? When setting up the first fuel dump, we need to divide our 2 gallons of fuel across a total of 6 trips. That's only a third of a gallon per trip. A third of a gallon will take us 10 miles, so that's how far away we place the first fuel dump. The second fuel dump divides our 2 gallons of fuel across 4 trips, half a gallon per trip, which is 15 miles further down the road. Finally, one trip to rescue your man and one trip back is a whole gallon, or 30 miles each way. By planning my trip backwards from the end, I knew that I only needed 2 fuel dumps. I knew the final dump could be 30 miles from the stranded man. Because I had to complete this part of the trip 4 times, it could only be 15 miles further back. The next one had to be 10 miles back from there. And fortunately, that's where our base camp is. This decreasing series of fractions is called the harmonic series, and we can use it to travel any distance by making smaller and smaller initial steps.
The point is, you gotta plan the trip in advance. First trip, you go out a third. Second trip, you go out a half. Third part of it, you go out the whole way, and then you can come back with your friend. 3 trips, 6 gallons. Had I not spent who knows how long it was doing the wrong thing, I'd feel very, very clever.
So how far can you actually go with this method?
Well, because that's divergent, that means you can add terms for that to go to infinity. You could go forever. That guy is fine.
Not with us. I broke him in half.
Yeah, that was an unfortunate end to him, all right.
So I think although Braun was winning out, Dara and the students have,
took a while
saved
to get
the day for maths, I think.
I spent a lot of time working on the problem with a car that was so fast I could have just driven there and come back. And
just
so
by
I'm in many
off the
ways.
Gas and rolling.
Literally, I could have coasted back and gone, hey, how's your day in the desert? And going, that was all right, you know. A little bit scared at the end, but like, you know, I knew you had this super fast car that could drive out on 2 gallons of petrol and drive me home again.
I think we should come to who actually won the show. I think Josh and Marcus, you did the first 2 problems and pretty nearly the most efficient. So I think this week actually the overall winners, Josh and Marcus,
well
Braun.
Done.
Good
well
work,
done.
Sir.
Congratulations.
Very good.
Mathematical Braun. Nothing better than learning something by not getting it right. Thanks, by the way, to our Bright Young Things of students on our maths panel. Thanks to our Phoenix Questions out of the Pride of Oxford, Professor Marcus de Sotoy. And thanks mainly to our winners this week, guest comedians, no longer mathophobic, Marcus and Josh. We'll have more of these problems another time on our School of Hard Sums. Thank you very much. Good night.
And now time for your homework. On the way to school, you have to pass three bullies in turn along your route. Each one always takes half your lunch money, but then gives you £1 because they feel sorry for you. How much lunch money should you take to school to make sure you have £2 when you get there for a salad? If you'd like to take a look at the answer, or just cheat, go to the website, joindave.co.uk.